No, we were doing chapter and empire across three continents. So, you know, the Roman Empire was a vast empire as it was spread over three continents. So, how it was possible for the emperor to cope with the control and administration of such a vast and diverse set of territories? With a population of some 6 crore in the mid-second century? So, the answer lies within the urbanization of the empire. So today the topic is administration of a vast empire. So all the territories, okay, it was organized into provinces and they were subject to taxations. If we talk about this province, you can see Carthage, Alexandria, Antioch. Okay, they were built in the near the Mediterranean Sea. They laid the foundations, or you can see what the foundation of the imperial systems. So it was through the cities, okay, that the government was able to tax the provincial countryside. It generated much of the wealth of the empire. So it means that the upper class of the countryside, they actively collaborated with the Roman state in, first of all, in administering this their own territories, and second, for raising taxes for them. So here a new elite, emergence or rise of a new elite class. Here elite class are the upper classes of these provinces. So throughout the second and the third centuries, the new administrators or the officials, they were recruited from these upper classes. So most of the cadres who governed the cities and command the armies. So the most interesting aspects of Roman political history, now the power, it shift from senator to the elite group of these provinces. So it became more powerful than the senatorial class. Okay, because now they hold the backing or the support of the emperor. So as this power emerged, the new power here, new elite class, the ruler at that time was Gallienus, who excluded or removed the senators in the place of these elite groups and give way to consolidate their power to rise. So we are told that Gallienus, he forbade senators, which means he prohibited senators from serving in the empire or in army or having access to it, in order to prevent control of the empire from falling into their hands. So the members who were recruited from these new provinces into army and administration as a citizenship spread to these reasons. So this new reason, they got the citizenship, the people got the citizenship, okay, and it was no longer confined to Italy. Earlier the senators from Italy origin, they continued to dominate the senates, but later you can see from these provinces became, now they came into majority. So this trend, they reflect the general decline of Italy within the empire, with politically as well as economically. And the rise of the new elite class, as they are wealthier and most urbanized part of the Mediterranean, such as the South Spain, Africa, and the east of Mediterranean. They are prosperous because of trade. Now come meanings of a Roman city. So a city in the Roman sense was an urban center, if you call a city, with its own magistrate, its city council, and you can see a territory containing village under its jurisdictions. Okay, if you talk at the legal decision and judgment were under the territory. So in case of imperial favor, here the favor of the ruler, okay, any town can be given the status of village, and the village could be upgraded as city. So when we talk about the advantages of living in the city of Roman Empire, so you can see one crucial advantage of living in the city was simply that it might be better provided for during the food shortage and famine than in the countryside. So this you can better understand with the statement of Dr. Galen. There was a famine for many successive years, resulted in food scarcity, illness called due to malnutritions that can be simply understood by anyone. But the people living in the city, as they were having the facility of hoarding the grains, they collect enough grain for a whole year after the harvest and carried out all the wheat, barley, beans and lentils and store it and left a small proportion of grain to the farmers. So after consuming what was left in the course of the winter, the countryside had to depend on unhealthy food in the springs. So they ate twigs, shoots of the tree and bushes and bulbs and roots of inedible plant. So another striking features of Roman urban life was public bath. When one Iranian ruler tried to introduce the public bath into Iran, he encountered extreme angers of the clergy there. Water was a sacred element, and to use it for public bathing may have seemed or a violation or disrespect to the sacredness. Then come the third striking features was urban population. It enjoyed much higher level of entertainment. So you can see the calendar tell us that the spectacular or the show no less than 176 days. It means that in the Roman calendar there was 176 days, and for each day there would be entertainment or show. So when we see the city life, it was more or far more superior to the life in the village. So now come to the third century crisis. The period of 1st century AD and the 2nd century, it was a period, okay, it was free from civil war and a period of peace, prosperity and economic expansion. But the 3rd century, you can see it was a period of crisis, internal conflict as well as external. So from 230, the Roman Empire found itself fighting in several fronts simultaneously. In Iran, a new and more aggressive dynasty, you can see, okay, that emerged in 225. They called themselves as Sasanian, and within just 15 years they spread over Euphrates. So here a ruler, Shapur first, okay, the Iranian ruler claimed he had crushed Roman army of 60,000 and even captured the eastern capital of Antioch, which was mentioned in an inscription on three languages. And on the another frontier, a confederacy of Germanic tribes. Here you can see confederacy, union and groups, okay, of many tribes. Here the tribes are the, and they begin to move, these tribes, they begin to move against the Rhine and the Danube. So the Alemanni, the Franks and Goths, so they were prominent, okay, among these tribes. The Roman Empire had to face many invasion, or you can see several invasion from the year 233 AD to 280. The Roman were forced to abandon much of the territories, okay, and you can see beyond the Danubes, they called these Germanic tribes barbarian. It means they are uncivilized people or tribe. So the strain they faced by the empire are the evident from the rapid successions of empire in the 3rd century. You can see 25 emperors, they came and went in a span of 47 years. So now we see the gender, literacy and culture. So the society of ancient Rome was defined by its culture. Why did people still talk about ancient Rome so many centuries later? It because of the culture of that time. And the place was as unique as it was influential. So expansion brought Rome into contact with many diverse cultures. The cultural diversities, okay, can be reflected in any form and any level. One is the religion. You can know the vast diversity of religious cult and local deities. So different form of religious communities and their worship of several gods and goddesses. Then you can find here plurality of languages was spoken. Many local languages were in practice. The style of dress and the costumes, the food that they ate, फॉर्म ऑफ सोशल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, इसमें डिफरेंट क्लास, कम्युनिटी, जेंडर, ट्राइबल और नॉन ट्राइबल ग्रुप्स. देन वी सी द पैटर्न्स ऑफ सेटलमेंट बेस्ड ऑन हायरकी और क्लास और द सेटलमेंट ऑफ सिटी दैट डिफर फ्रॉम द सेटलमेंट ऑफ विलेज. सो वेन वी टॉक अबाउट द लैंग्वेजेस, हियर यू कैन सी अरमाइक वॉज द डोमिनेंट लैंग्वेजेस ग्रुप ऑफ द नियर ईस्ट. नियर ईस्ट आर द ईस्ट ऑफ मेडिटेरेनियन. So you can see the Coptic was spoken in Egypt, Punic and Berber in North Africa, Celtic in Spain and in Northwest. But many of this linguistic culture was purely oral. Oral until you can see a script was invented for them or they start writing. So Armenian, for example, only began to be written as late as 5th century. Whereas there was already a Coptic language or translation of the Bible by the middle of 3rd century. The Bible was translated in Coptic languages. So you can see spread of Latin. It displaced many languages with the passage of time. So now we talk about the gender. So you can see instead of family, gender here reveal about the male and female of the family, as the female considerably enjoy legal rights. So one of the most more modern features of Roman society was the widespread prevalence of the nuclear family. And you can see adult son did not live with their family, and it was exceptional for adult brother also to share or to live joint family. On the other hand, you can see slaves were included in the family. And when we talk about the marriage, is a typical form of marriage were there, where the wife did not transfer, you can see, her authority or her property to his husband, but retained full right in her father's property. Okay, the woman remained a prime, you can see, primary heir, or you can see she was legally entitled to the property and became an independent property owner on her father's death. So you can see, if you talk to the Roman women, they enjoyed considerably legal rights in owning and managing property. She enjoyed complete legal independence. As far as the divorce is concerned, it was relatively easy.